This UCLA and USC join the Big Ten edition of the Sports Gambling Podcast is presented by WinBet. Bet $50 to WinBet and get $200 in free bets. Bet big, win bigger with WinBet. Download the WinBet app now or visit WINNBet.com and start winning today. We're also brought to you by Sleeper. You already play fantasy on Sleeper, but now you can win cold hard cash with their over-under game. Just head to sleeper.com/SGP on your phone to join the SGPN group, and Sleeper will automatically match your first deposit up to $100. That's sleeper.com/SGP. And make sure to check out our relaunched merch store where you can get all your favorite SGPN gear. Just go to store.sportsgamblingpodcast.com. Welcome everyone to the Sports Gambling Podcast. I'm Sean, stacking the money green with my partner in picks, Ryan, Real Money Kramer. What's happening, Crame?
Dog. Just the two of us over here, lonely, sad about the future of college football. Bring him on. Rest in peace.
Joining us to discuss the state of college football, Colby Dant, aka the Dant to Base. What's happening, Colby?
It's all about the goddamn money, all right? To quote the great Nick Nolte in Blue Chips.
He's so angry. That was not the level you brought me on the check.
Ryan, it was pretty great when so obviously we're breaking down the news. USC, UCLA joining. Right now it's just football and basketball supposedly, but they're expecting all sports with the noted exception of beach volleyball, as NC Nick pointed out on Twitter. RIP beach volleyball. I don't know what they're going to do, but Colby was saying, yeah, someone's saying that Big Ten championship game is going to be happening at SoFi in Los Angeles. And I go, oh, that sounds awesome. And Colby looked at me as if I threw his mom down a flight of stairs, just the disdain in his eyes. Very, very angry. Colby, before we get your reaction, shout out to WinBet, where you can bet big, win bigger, NFL, college football, WNBA, whatever, MLB, whatever you're getting into this summer, you get into it over at WinBet. For every $500 bet, you get an automatic entry between now and the end of July for their ultimate fantasy football experience, including two night stay at Wynn Resorts for you and your entire league. Multiple entries are allowed. So much to choose from. Download that WinBet app or visit WINNBet.com. Offer subject to change. Terms and conditions at WinBet.com. Must be 21 or older and present in the state where playthrough WinBet is available. If you or someone you know has a gambling problem, call 1-800-522-4700. What was your initial reaction, Colby, when you saw the news?
I just thought Texas, fuck Texas, because wow, Texas really? Texas is the catalyst of all of this. All this conference of realignment was started with the Texas Longhorns and their little fucking network a long time ago. and yeah, once again, you see tradition sacrifice, you know, we lose tradition. And now, I mean, that UCLA Rutgers rivalry is really going to heat up, Sean. It's just a classic example of money ruining everything that's good. And I don't think college football got better by this move.
Wow.
Well, I mean, define
better.
As a TMZ fan, as a sharp handicapper, I'm looking forward to USC, Penn State, UCLA, Ohio State. Like, I think from a purely, I understand if you like traditions and the rivalries and things that date back 100 years, but game wise, I think we're gonna UCLA, USC going up against these bigger name programs in the Big Ten. I think we'll make for exciting football.
Maintaining games. The popularity of the sport has nothing to do with tradition.
Yeah.
That's the rear view mirror.
I would disagree because if you've seen Nick Saban calling out and you've seen all these people saying college football attendances are at record lows, it's because they chase the dollar. They did not chase what the fan gets excited for. The fan gets excited to see West Virginia, Virginia Tech, or Pittsburgh, West Virginia, or Colorado, Nebraska, or Nebraska, Oklahoma, they do not get excited for Rutgers and UCLA.
Well, here's where I'll disagree with you. They get excited for a matchup that happens frequently when both teams are good. Most good rivalries are born out of two good teams battling at a high frequency. So I would argue that whatever happens, however things shake out, I have a feeling they'll be able to materialize. Maybe it's like a 3-5-5 type schedule model over a bigger league size that allows you to recreate, you know, high frequency matchups where you're playing every year and or playing more teams more frequently, which is what they're trying to do, right? They want more teams going to more places to allow for better recruiting, to say, hey, we're going to have a road game here. We're going to have access to this state. We're going to do that. We're going to do that. To say it sucks because tradition is gone is cool, but this gets us closer to a real playoff that makes sense, that makes more money. Because right now they're
that doesn't captive. Mean that's not why we are college football fans, man. You guys are more, you know, I get it. You're college football fans.
No, but you want college
football. I want it at its stake now. I don't want it with what it's going to be in the future.
But you have, there's concession. There's always compromise and change.
And I'm not willing to make that compromise. There's a reason why I still love college football the way it was when I first started watching it.
So would you rather have no playoff, single champ, like not eight, like? Just how it used to be 20 years ago, or how it's going to be in 20 years?
Probably 20 years ago, okay. For sure. The rivalries are.
I don't know why I asked the question. Yeah.
What? So you're asking Colby if he likes something better in the past or how it's currently? Wow. Hold on. Well, honestly,
I asked future.
Tell me one rivalry. Tell me one. List any of these years that we've expanded and got. You know, the Big East moved to the ACC. Tell me one thing that's benefited from it. We thought it's going to be so great. Miami and Florida State are going to be, you know, they're both going to be in the ACC. You know, we got Virginia Tech and Syracuse. They're going to be in the ACC. Missouri and A&M. They're going to be in the SEC. Where have they ever show me the wins. Show me the track history of this being a good thing for the sport.
Well, I think the, you know, easy place to start is let's just look at the small conferences. Look at all the access these small conferences have to TV now. That didn't happen before. Maction, that this was an idea. Hey, we're small. We have to do something to compete. We have to fill a crack somewhere. This is how business works. This is when you hear things like disruption, right? You need to disrupt a market to gain that market share you're looking for. And maybe if college football conferences treated their product more like a business. And I know you don't like this answer, Colby, but the evolution that you're looking for to an absolute pure like playoff is probably never going to get there.
Is the FCS.
But are we closer to a place where we just have a couple more levels that have their own playoff? So more teams have access to playoff, to championship hopes, even if it's at a different level, right? Even if there's an unfair glass ceiling that doesn't allow a mid-major team to jump up, that's fine. What if we had a mid-major fucking playoff? That would be rad. We would watch it.
I'd
a
watch
college
it.
Football fan would love that.
Well, that's what we're hoping for.
I hear
for.
You, yeah. but I think your rage has you too focused. Well,
what is the good? What is the good? I have yet to understand what the
Ryan
good
was
from
just
this is.
Saying. I think the good is you get closer,
more premium football at the end of the year, more playoff premium football. What every other level of football does, which is settle things in a proper playoff. We are closer to that because the business model of these leagues will be to sell playoff fucking football, make money off of a playoff product, make money off of the best teams at each level playing off to see who the champion is.
But if
is.
They only are playing each other, I just think it's different. It's
that
different
brings new that. Rivalry. That brings modern tradition.
See, that brings the NFL. And there's a reason why. Look, and I'm not shitting on the NFL.
The kids are being paid, though.
No, I'm saying there's a reason why I fell in love with college football the first time I started watching football, and that is because the game was purer, in my opinion.
I get it.
Right?
The tits are sagging a little further to the floor.
And to me, if you're gonna make that another form of pro football, and not allow in certain institutions, I mean. I don't like it. I don't like where this thing's going. We'll see. Hopefully I'm wrong.
But what do you mean not allow certain institutions?
I worry, will Army even play these guys? Will certain things that are such a rich history with college
if
football.
You are
will
a,
they even be allowed to play these guys? Because they're going to be in
I
their
don't
own,
see how this yeah. impacts like Army Navy or Army
everything. I mean, even like East Carolina stuff like that. It is a great thing that they have.
You will have the idea of new leagues, and those leagues will be filled with members. Now, membership will be bought in most cases by large conferences, but I think these conferences also have to be smart, whether it's finding teams to catch losses or fucking PR.
How are you going to feel
if you were in the Premier League? Would you not want Air Force, Army, and fucking Navy there if they wanted to be there?
Okay, but we're doing a lot. Like, how would you feel if Virginia? There's a strong chance that Virginia Tech could end up an independent. The ACC is probably going to be gone. The Pac-12 is probably going to be gone.
I don't think Virginia Tech will be independent. I think Virginia Tech will find some other. I think ultimately we're going to get to four super conferences.
If we're being honest, Virginia Tech is spending enough money. This is a money conversation. And if Virginia Tech, a team willing to spend the same money as Clemson now with the new coaching staff, that tells me the athletic director understands what's going on and they're going to be a part of the future. But yeah, if they were a part of, say, the second tier, would I be bummed out? Yeah. Would it be the end of the world? No. It would be disappointing. But if they're now competing for championships, it's intriguing to the fan base. And I just like soccer.
Is it though? I don't know that it's intriguing to the fan base. I think
do FCS fans root for their teams?
Yes. But a lot of that once again is based off of rivalries that have been there 100 years,
but they still root for their team to win a championship. And I think you see FCS teams come up to the FBS all the time. And I think this new league or whatever we call this, the new group of conferences, I think there will be some movement with teams because I think there will be teams that come up and I think there will be teams that go down. And it sounds like everyone wants it to be this fixed, like super league of pro teams. The difference is they are universities. And unless they completely break off and run a sports team as a, like this pro entity, just associated to like the colors and name of a university.
They're going to break off from the NCAA,
but the NCAA is a crooked piece of shit organization. Like
I'm not defending that
change for the sport.
Well, no, it depends on what they break off with.
But
I'm not just, if you just took like the top 40 teams in the nation and you threw them in there, then no, I don't think it got better. I would prefer it with the crooked NCAA.
Yeah, unfortunately, like slave labor and things like that will help with creating equality and making rivalries out of forcefulness. You have to do something. You have to do it. Now, if we can evolve by getting rid of the NCAA, figuring out a way to actually play playoffs, and the byproduct is we have two or three levels of FBS football. I don't see how that's a net negative change, because I would imagine in the future, like things are happening and being more progressive as we go. So I think teams will move. I think the idea of team movement will be a thing. I think when you think of European soccer, you think of people that root for their club, no matter what level.
Well, Colby,
they're on.
At the very least, this hurts SEC, right? Or puts them in a downgrade. Wouldn't you support that? It hurts ESPN and their stranglehold.
Oh, by the way, sure, but I
Big
still
Ten
don't think
holds a winning record over the SEC over the last 5 years, I believe. Colby, you can correct me if I'm wrong, but I believe if you filter out the SEC non-conference stuff, the Big Ten actually holds a lead over the SEC.
I'm not sure. I'm not sure. I know, like the Pac-12.
It's close.
Yeah, but
I'm gonna say they have a lead.
I don't know. I just think it's weird because if the Pac-10 now or whatever. If they end up merging with the Big 12 teams, once again, if I think you're gonna find less and less fans. I think if you're a fan of Oregon State and your new rival deemed by conference play is Kansas, who gives a fuck? I think the sport got hurt today, and I think it's gonna continue to get hurt. And I don't know that that's a good thing long term. I don't know that fans will get excited. I think fan interest could go down.
I mean, they said the same thing when they changed the height of the mound. I think change is often resisted, right? Like the seatbelt was going to completely change society and destroy.
A good example is the ACC, because the ACC went out and grabbed Big East teams, and now they complain that, hey, Syracuse fans, they don't travel to Florida State. They don't travel to Miami. They don't travel. You know why? Because that's fucking far.
Yeah.
All right. And when that happens, it ruins it. It ruins what they had. They used to be able to just hop in the car and drive an hour and go see Stanford Cal or whatever it is.
But that's a metaphor for society. We are connected further apart now. The internet has allowed us to change the way we live.
Sorry, metaphor for society.
I can't wait for Virginia Tech's new rival to be New Mexico State.
I'm strangely crushing Colby at this college football.
All right, but let's be honest. Let's get serious. What am I going to do with all that Alliance gear that I purchased knowing that I was going to be a fan of the conference. Yeah. I'm an Alliance. Hey, fan.
The best was, this is not a written contract. It's a gentleman's deal. Back when they made that thing, it's a handshake deal. Oh, wow. How'd that work out for you, Clem?
I love the seriousness of it. Colby immediately threw on the Fine Bomb show, getting some great, great callers on the Fine Bomb show.
Always.
And, but just like the tone that he like came back from commercial, it's like, we continue to discuss the like events of today. Happened. Yes. It's like it was a historic day.
6:30, 2022.
We all remember where we were when the two pillars, the two towers of the Pac-12 came crumbling down into the Big Ten.
It is funny because in that aspect, especially it's a brand new day and age for college football with the NIL and stuff, and with them claiming Rutgers right there, New York City TV market, Chicago, and now LA, they do have a great blueprint going forward for being successful and perhaps maybe much more successful than the SEC when you consider those TV markets and how much money you can pull in from those ratings.
Yeah, I mean, again, it's an access to markets from TV, but it's also you rise the whole level of the conference. I mean, we've discussed this before, but the recruiting aspect of being able to say, hey, we come to Florida, we come to California.
And there's a sneaky, again, I do see Colby's points. If they start destroying some of these conference rivalries, I think they will still figure out how to keep some of these rivalries intact because it's good for the money. Like Oregon State will always figure out a way to play Oregon, I think, because it's in their both financial interests. Like maybe it's not, maybe it's technically an out of conference game, but I still think.
But that's what we thought 20 years ago when these things expanded. And have we seen? I mean, I think we're getting Pitt, West Virginia for the first time this year in like 14 years or 12 years, whatever it was. These things don't have, we thought that before, and we haven't got a great sample size of that.
Well, now I think again, it's almost creating more freedom for these schools. So maybe we will, maybe we won't. Breaking news, Jong Lee, UCLA fan, saying in the chat, UCLA Rutgers in Rose Bowl tailgate. I'm there. Sign me up for that. There's a lot of East Coast transplants that I think will go. Or just transplants in general that will go to these. How many people have you met out here in LA, Colby, that are fans of Big Ten football teams that would go to these games at the Rose Bowl?
Yeah, it would be like Wisconsin.
Rutgers is not an exception, but
Iowa or something.
Yeah, even Northwestern, Penn State, USC. We get to see that every year.
Yeah.
I see Colby's concern as a longtime historic fan, but as a TMZ fan, to Kramer's point, if this gets us to a 16 team playoff, or if this gets us with playoff like games at the end of the season, I'm all for it. You know what also I'm all for? Sleeper. That's right. We are waist deep in our sleeper fantasy draft for our dynasty team. Dynasty teams, and you probably already have a league, fantasy league on Sleeper. Download Sleeper on your mobile phone, and now start getting paid over on Sleeper. Not only through your fantasy league, whatever you guys work out on the side, but now you can play their over under game, and they make it super easy. Start you off with 100% deposit bonus up to $100. Sleeper.com/SGP. Sleeper.com/SGP. Go there on your phone. Automatically match your first deposit up to $100. You join our squad. You can copy our picks. We can copy yours. It is a ton of fun. And people keep grinding out MLB player props. I've had a couple close calls on some big sleeper caches. So stay tuned because I got one coming. If you're giving out a sweet player prop parlay in the sleeper chat, tag me at Sean T Green. If it hits, I'll give you a SGP hoodie from the brand new merch store. Terms and conditions apply. See Sleeper's terms of use for details. All right, so we figured out whether or not this was good, and now since we are a
well, what's your vote? Is it good?
That's an interesting question. I would say if it ultimately leads us to a 16-team playoff, which I see the path now much easier, I would say good. I would lean good.
Even if that side effect is that the maybe three teams a year that would might come from a mid-major to be a, you know, long shot to win the national title now have 0% chance to win the top level title.
Again, I'm totally fine with completely realigning everything and making it, you know, say 40 teams, four conferences, however you want to say, like South Power, North Power, and then like there's the SEC, whatever, however you want to break it out. 40 to 50 teams are competing for the championship. 16 teams get into the playoff. And then from, and maybe like, you know, the next 90 have their own spread, you know, conferences spread out. And then those teams are also playing a 16 team playoff. I'm fine with two separate college football playoffs that to me that are both technically FBS. Like, why don't we go back to like division one, two, and three?
I have a solution.
Like you make FCS three, make the non power five division two, and then make everyone that's spending this ungodly money division one.
You break the country up into quadrants.
Okay. Oh, I thought you meant, oh, just for football purposes.
Yeah. Like you are. So maybe it's the Big Ten and the SEC. They sit down. Maybe there's some like, you know, the ACC and the Pac 12 are there too. And you sit down with these people and you say, okay, you're going to be the czar of the West. You're going to be the czar of the central of the East and the South or whatever we decide.
Yeah.
And so each one is filled up with maybe
12 teams.
Let's just say 16 teams.
Okay. 16,
four times 16 is 64.
Yeah. Right?
So then you have 16 teams in each region, and maybe each region has multiple levels.
Yeah.
Perhaps there's no real way to jump levels, but maybe that's just how we're going to break stuff up. And then, so you, cause I do think Colby's right. Like the one thing about college that is fun is that regional aspect of it.
Yeah. I would say that would be, and to Colby's point there, I would say that would be my biggest beef with the current, with UCLA and USC.
So, but
going to Big Ten, it sucks if they don't also figure out some other teams that come with them in the Big Ten.
Oregon, that are Washington, maybe the
Stanford. Yeah, I don't know. Like, it's also tough to judge this just because I don't think it's done yet. You know?
So you have your regions, and then I think you just take the NFL model. You figure out a way. Say, okay, of the 16 like regional teams, you play seven. And then you always are going to play two games against the East or rotate the other. So you're going to play teams from everywhere every year.
This is your dream though. This isn't reality, right?
No, but I'm saying like what the reality is why wouldn't these commissioners of these fake conferences, like do the conferences really matter at the football level is my point. Like,
I mean, the SEC commissioner has an ego, man. And the big, well, the Big Ten commissioner has an ego. So, they are not going to want, I mean, I do think they'll be missing something.
So the Big Ten commissioner becomes the commissioner of the North League and, or the East League or whatever. And the SEC commissioner becomes the commissioner of the South League. And like they maintain power positions within this ecosystem, but it allows them to then build this league, right? Isn't that what they're trying to achieve? A pro league, you know, a league that you'd have to buy your way into. So yeah, I mean, I think
they're just trying to do the best for themselves from a TV deal. I don't know that they've looked that far ahead. I mean, I think yes, slightly, but this is right before a TV deal, dude. This was completely with that in mind.
And the reaction, and you know, it's almost certainly like people are saying, the reaction will be that football will just break off because the other sports can't afford to. You know, Rutgers, maybe other sports don't have the budget to hop in the private jet and fly out to the Rose Bowl with Greg Schiano and the boys.
But I mean, I don't think it's a win. I think the sport needs that. That's what makes college football. That's
this
why
was fans, always going to happen.
Fans care because of that. They don't care because, like I always say, if you put like the top two teams and you play the game at a neutral site, I think those games suck. I think the better games are the passion of college football.
The bottom line is that at the end of the day, the second the players started getting paid, everyone could get as greedy as possible. And then everything was out there because Now that kids are getting played, they got to squeeze bigger profits. The collectives have to find a way to get that money. And so everything becomes about money. So the first thing you're always going to do as a business is say, where can we be just with our current content strategy? Like SGPN has these conversations all the time. How can we do more with what we have already? Oh, well, we can just enter California. We can just enter that marketplace.
True. But all right. Yeah, I don't know. I mean, look, I'd say this as my last point.
Sean thinks it's
careful
positive.
What you wish for, because I can remember how great Arkansas was before they joined the SEC. And now they're an afterthought. So watch out. I would think that the team that really would stand out there would be Oklahoma when they join the SEC. But
to the point, right? I think the number one thing that no one thinks about because the answer is you always say yes when the pretty girl invites you to the dance. But what no one thinks about is someone in this league has to lose 8 games. Someone in this league has to lose 9 games.
And you lose the soul of the sport. You know what I mean? Losing the soul of the sport.
I can't argue the soul conversation.
The soul of the sport is betting on it, and that's why we are going to be.
We still will bet on it.
Yes, I'm not going to refute.
Very true.
It's going to be football. We'll watch it. We'll bet on it. We're going to be rolling out a conference win total podcast. But we thought since UCLA and USC in the news, and we're not going to give out a podcast without giving you some picks. Why not get an early look at? UCLA, the Bruins, and the USC win total as well. Break those down.
And you got to, I mean, look, even though I don't like potentially, or I don't like this move happening, I hope I'm wrong. I love the fact that now they just put a target on themselves. All these games are going to be fantastic. It's much like with Texas when Kansas beat Texas last year, seeing all those fans get heated, see the message boards light up with all this shit talk.
Some drama.
So I mean, look, I put it like this. I was leaning like for sure on an over here, and I was like, oh, but now they have a gigantic fucking target on their back.
I do think it could affect. We'll just get to it here. These win totals brought to you by IPVanish.com/SGP. Go there, lock up your internet security, keep it safe. Again, highly recommend using a VPN. Great for a streaming stick. You can hide your location. 70% off their yearly plan. I don't know. I don't know how these guys do it. IPVanish.com/SGP. All right. What are we doing? UCLA first?
Yeah, because I have the bet. I'm just gonna lead off with the winner. We're DTR Heisman 80-1. Throw it down.
Ooh.
Throw it down.
Some of that Chip Kelly, Sam Bradford stock, Sean.
He almost wasn't the guy, but he is the guy. To your point, they might have a target on their back, but that means people might be watching a little closer. And this dude has been playing college football for a while.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Woo.
Yeah.
And he's in a Chip Kelly offense. They can put up numbers, and it's in LA. I guess that hurts a little bit because of the West Coast bias, but this certainly will make UCLA a team that people are interested in.
We were certainly high on UCLA last year. Maybe we were like a year early. Although to our credit, UCLA, it was their best year, the Chip Kelly era. I think by a long.
He's finally getting it's his guys, and
it's we're going into the fifth year for Chip Kelly. There was one COVID year there where they played like 4 games,
and he wanted a better quarterback.
Yeah,
but then he was able to get like he's still. I mean, would you say you're still excited if you're a UCLA fan getting him back, right?
Yeah. Yeah, definitely. Definitely. I mean, are we talking DTR? Definitely. I mean, he's a very good quarterback.
Yeah. So, I mean, to see that he's 80-1, I mean, you look at the schedule, Colby, I'm sure you know the schedule back and forth, but
it's bowling, actually one of ECU's easy. I mean, not ECU's, UCLA's easiest schedules.
Bowling Green.
Pretty favorable Pac-12 schedule.
Yeah. So too. Bowling Green, Alabama State, South Alabama, to open the season. Then you get at Colorado, catch Washington and Utah at home. At Oregon would be the one you circle. Stanford at home, at Arizona State. Who knows what's going on there at that point. Arizona at home, SC you catch at home, and then at Cal. I don't think we project them to be very good this year. So I mean,
Let's walk through. What's their win total at?
We got their win total at 8.5. And that's
where are the
-110 for both sides of this.
Let's walk through it. Bowling Green. Okay. At so home.
First three non conference. Bowling Green, Alabama State, South Alabama.
Absolutely pathetic non conference schedule right there by UCLA. Right.
Next block of three at Colorado, Washington at home, Utah.
But Washington and Utah are two teams that they could lose to.
They could absolutely lose to them.
I'll go.
They'll split.
I'll go 2-1. I got them 5-1.
Colorado's not very good though.
I got them 5-1 out there for six as well.
At Oregon, that's Stanford at home. At Arizona State, that's 2-1 as well.
Really, I got them 1-2 there. I got them losing at Oregon and at the desert.
No, Arizona State's program could be in complete turmoil.
Hard to win in the desert, man. People don't. That's another thing. When people handicap the Pac-12, I think it's the hardest terrain wise. One week you're playing on. In front of no one against Stanford, desert. Then you're up in the mountains, then you're up in the rain in Oregon, and then you're really at the desert.
You almost sound like.
All right, so I got him at 7-2 at this point. So you have him at 6-3.
6-3,
and Sean, I think, also has. We'll say six.
I'll go 7-2.
Yeah. So then we closed it out with Arizona, USC, and at Cal. Even if I throw a loss in here just to say fuck it, I'm still at 9-3. I'm still at over. And so the target on the back, does it worry me a little bit? Yeah, but what are these pussy ass Pac-12 schools gonna do about it?
You know, I mean, to Ryan's point, like where do you get that fourth loss? So I think
in which game will UCLA not have a quarterback edge? That would be my question.
I don't know, man. There's a lot of good quarterbacks in the Pac-12. I mean, Stanford's got Tanner McKee, who's a projected first rounder. If you ask some people, Jason DeLora just went to Arizona. Washington's got Michael Penix coming from Indiana. You have some good quarterback play in this conference, though. Dude, I'm on the under, and I feel pretty good about
really?
It.
Really?
Yeah.
Woo.
Another thing is UCLA has some offensive line problems.
Oh.
I'm concerned about depth just because they had one good year.
Maybe
it did feel like they probably would have went 9-4 last year. The Holiday Bowl got canceled, so they probably would have got that extra win. Who have they lost? How are their levels of seniors returning, Colby?
Well, I mean, last year was kind of their more experienced year when it comes to that. bringing back Dorian Thompson Robinson is because of super senior eligibility. Yeah,
that's huge though for a quarterback position. True, but
this conference,
look at Pitt. Dude, it just happened.
All these quarterbacks are very experienced. I mean, okay, maybe Oregon with Bo Nix, he's younger, but the other ones, like, I mean, USC's got Caleb Williams, who's a five star. Cal's bringing in Jack Plummer from Purdue.
Great name, by the way.
He's good, though. He's good quarterback.
Yeah, I guess also some of this, I think, it's not directly correlated except for that one game, but it, you know, how you feel about UCLA.
They have eight starters returning on as a whole out of 22 possible starters. They have eight returning. Now they bring in some transfers from Duke. I think Jake Bobo was one.
Well, I see why the juice is split, because them finding that fourth loss, I don't think is insane. But I would go over. I think they're 9-3 before they're 8-4. They have a good. I mean, they just had a lot of momentum and that super soft schedule to get them started. I think UCLA is as a team, bit of a front runner. So I think they'll be all right. And I think they could win at Oregon.
I mean, a lot of those are 50-50. They could also lose at home to Stanford. If anything, I think Stanford has a great record against them recently.
That's true.
That's what I'm saying. All these games are kind of. I just think 7-5. Well, and
they don't
have
to play. They don't have to play Utah on the road. I think that's always a tough spot. Don't have to go up to Washington. I mean,
bottom line is, it's going to be a track meet, I think. And I mean, which teams are they playing early in this schedule that are going to keep up with them? So I do think they're going to.
I think they'll start out hot. I think they'll be 4-0, but I think they'll go 1-1 with the Washington Utah thing. There's a solid chance they go 0-2 there. I mean, the head coach of Washington was coming over from Fresno State. Fresno State beat them in the Rose Bowl last year.
If they run the table,
through
the bye week.
Oh, okay.
We're we're talking about a Dorian Thompson Robinson Heisman ticket going for what, 15-1. We're selling that 80-1 at that point.
Yeah.
I'm going for 2-1. Is that not a crazy price for a seventh year, whatever he is, sixth year?
You feel good about 9-3 though, huh?
I would take 9-3 before I give 8-4.
Mm.
Now what about 10-2 versus 7-5?
I think it's highly unlikely that
10-2
I actually think they're going to be 7-5. Like I think it's more likely. I actually think the most probable result is 7-5. Really? Maybe 8-4.
I think having a super senior quarterback that's going to do what Chip Kelly wants to do.
And another thing is you got to remember that they don't really have a home field advantage. So when Utah plays, like Utah will travel and it'll probably be like 50-50.
It's true. I was at a UCLA,
but I think they get
I wasn't.
They'll get. We watched them beat LSU in a building that LSU had dominated.
That's a great point.
I mean,
and that was also probably the beginning to the end for Coach O.
Yeah, but that you know, I would rather be bullish on Chip Kelly in his fifth year than Lincoln Riley in his first.
More importantly, what game are we going to go to this year?
Ooh,
let's look at the schedule.
Ooh, I like that. I see a Friday game. Oh. Friday, September 30th, yes, against Washington.
Oh,
Friday night under the lights.
Pac-12 after dark.
Let's go.
Sign me up.
It does avoid youth soccer. That's
that was my main concern. Well, assuming Colby can get past security.
Yeah.
You can't. He's on the no-fly list.
I don't know if the Big Ten knows this, that you apparently you can't be much of a UCLA fan. They kick you out of the stadium if you start cheering for your own team so much. I don't know how that will fare, you know, with Wisconsin fans.
Colby,
think you could murder like seven people at a Wisconsin game and everything's fine, Sean.
In fairness, just about everyone in the section was seemed happy that you were.
That's because
you got.
That's because it's a wine and cheese crowd at UCLA. It's a bunch of losers.
You did get
a bunch of losers, either by birth or by choice. All right,
you did get applause from both UCLA and LSU fans. That's how I know.
The UCLA fans were you guys. All right.
No, we were not applauding. I trust me. I wasn't upset. I wasn't applauding.
If we could real quick. So UCLA's conference win total is at 5.5.
Mm.
This is an intriguing. They play 9 conference. So let's think about this, right? Which do you like more?
I kind of like the under on 5.5 because I think they could lose two.
I love the under.
I think they'll lose 2 conference and 1 non-conference, and that's how you get to 9-3, right?
No, they play 9 conference games.
Yeah, and that a conference.
So if they go
shit
under, then you're out because three conference wins is all they play outside. They play 9 in.
Oh
three
yeah,
out.
Never mind. I think they lose 2, so yeah, I guess then I would be on the under there.
I mean, it's not.
It's pretty much you're just basically taking those first 3 thing. Cupcake games. Will they lose one of those?
Yeah.
Or I get
you know. Remove the variance of them losing a random game. I guess
that's true because you know you would imagine they would be out for those conference games.
Maybe that's the same.
All right, let's do USC. What's their win total at sitting at over at WinBet?
I get what USC is. The win total is what I think 9.5. Ooh. Now this has been moving though. This has been all. I feel like. If you had checked it a month ago, I feel like it was different. But 9.5, and once again, the target. And this is the one that I really loved the over on before today.
Really?
Before today, I loved the over on.
I mean, I like this team. Obviously, you're bringing in Lincoln Riley, bunch of big name transfers, including Mario Williams, Caleb Williams. So, but it, to me, it's just like teams like this. I don't know. I feel like it almost takes a year because the expectations skyrocketing through the roof. You can only mess up. He certainly has a ton of talent. I know, like just looking at my early research, like Phil Steele's all over them to be the most improved and, you know, tons of stock up, tons of returning seniors. But all right, let's walk through the schedule. I think there's going to be some opportunities to lose at least.
They have no back-to-back away games though. Pac-12 was doing them a favor. They were finally starting to. Klavikov came in and he was like, "Whoa, whoa, whoa! Why are we giving our best teams back-to-back away? Let's relax on that." So
you want to walk
something
through?
To note?
Right. No, they have back-to-back away.
Rice.
Oh no, there's a bye in between.
Yeah. Rice at Stanford, which by the way, I was trying to explain to the little one that the Stanford's mascot was the cardinal, not cardinals. It's a tree. She thought it was pretty lame. Fresno State. That's something that's going to have to change with the new college football. Fresno State Bulldogs 3-0, right?
No, you want to. Stanford has owned them lately. I think Stanford has won what? Like, I think like seven of the past, and what, six of the past 10.
And Fresno State, I feel like, is kind of always scrappy. I don't. I haven't.
They're
going
to be really scrappy.
I haven't done my research.
17 returning starters.
Don't talk. So I want to impress you real quick. Our buddy Tedford's over there, is he not?
He's back.
Woo! We like Fresno State over this year.
And he returned 17 starters, and they have a Heisman hopeful quarterback in Jake Haener.
So here's my thing: why is Lincoln Riley the greatest thing since sliced bread?
He was at East Carolina.
He took over a program that was being kept pretty well for a long time.
True. He's a very innovating coach. You know, he comes from the school of Mike Leach. You know, he was a GA at Texas Tech when Mike Leach was there.
He scored a lot of points in the regular season and got some teams into the playoff.
But he normally actually always had a loss or two more than you would think in the regular season.
I was going to say, would you say he ever outperformed
he's never had more than two loss team though.
But has he ever really outperformed what people expected?
Maybe the first year. I think that he was there.
Anytime you're a first year coach, you're really coaching someone else's team.
I mean, I think he's a very cutting offensive mind.
Do we wonder if this guy is going to be able to correct a program that has had serious issues for a long time, systemic issues clearly throughout the USC. I mean, the college and the football organization, and to see,
does he like to drink?
Well, and to see a couple,
he was at ECU.
Colby mentioned it, but these are a couple, you know, teams that, you know, I don't think Fresno should have a chance to upset them, but who knows?
No, they will have.
And Stanford,
they're good.
To Colby's point, like that's a sneaky road trip. I'm not sure I'm buying all the Lincoln Riley sauce. As I start to look into this stuff, all right, at Oregon State, the Beavers, another really tough road trip in the Pac-12. Arizona State at home.
They'll beat Arizona State.
Washington State.
They'll beat Washington State.
Go Cougs at home.
Yep. And then they go to.
And then at Utah.
That's a loss.
Which I feel right before the bye week. So, Sean, what do you have for them right now? So, Rice at Stanford, Fresno. Do we want to predict an upset? 2-1? I'll say 2-1.
Yeah, I kind of think. And again, 2-1.
And then at Oregon State, Arizona State, Washington State, at Utah. That feels like
3-1.
That Oregon State trip is tough. I wonder.
Oregon State and at Utah. Utah is always a tough place.
Utah
to play.
Always smacks them at Rice.
And Utah before the bye week, you could look ahead towards that.
Let's see if I'm optimistic. I'll say 3-1 optimistically and see where I get to.
So I'm at 5-2.
Yes, me too. 3-1, 5-2. All right, Arizona after the bye week. Yet at Arizona, Cal. At home, Colorado at home. Is that 3-0?
Maybe. Wilcox at Cal is a very good defensive coach. I think it's a little sneakier of a game than people realize. But I mean, Wilcox turned down Oregon. He went to Oregon and he turned down Oregon to stay at Cal because he said he liked what his team had.
I think he goes. I think they go 3-0.
I'll say 3-0. I'll be optimistic again.
I'll say 3-0 too.
8-2. Yeah. And then we got at UCLA, Notre Dame to close out the season.
I think that someone will get them there. I got them 9-3.
Yeah, 9-3 feels right.
I got them 9-3. The defensive side of the ball, it's 9.5.
Yeah, you're right. 9-3. One of those they'll fall on.
Well, especially now with the target. Like this is something that's interesting that you were talking about. Is like Oregon State's not probably going to get an invite. I would bet the house. That Oregon State would not be invited to the Big Ten.
So I'm going over UCLA because I like the continuity of the quarterback, the program, everything, and then under on USC. I think they both go 9-3.
And I want to see what the juice. Yeah, so it's -125 on the over, +105 on the under.
I like getting the plus odds on that.
Yeah. So
I mean, USC does have more returning defensive starters, 3. And more returning offensive starters, 8 versus UCLA. But I do agree.
I guess continuity from a program sense, more less than players.
I think, you know, it's one thing when you're a pro team, you bring in a coach, whatever, even if losing tradition, whatever, it takes time, right? In college, I would argue it takes more time. And USC has been a shit show. Constantly talent flowing through this place. So I think this is where the test of Lincoln Riley, is he a good coach?
He is a good coach. I think they'll be winning this year. I don't think they'll be 10-2.
This is a different pressure situation than he was dealing with in Oklahoma.
There also is a scenario where, you know, he's never had this kind of defensive talent. He comes in, they hit the ground running, and they just don't lose a game. Like, I think that's in the range of outcomes for them, but I would take the other side just because I think something is going to go wrong.
I need
wrong.
To see that first before I'm. USC needs to, like, the last time USC was that team was when Pete Carroll was there.
And even Carroll had to build it after a couple of years. It wasn't just he just walked into
and
it.
And Pete Carroll's an elite motivator. Is Lincoln Riley an elite motivator?
I mean, he went to ECU, so
he's
fucking
nerd. We know he's a little nerd.
Well, I mean, look, I will say this. You could make the case that there's not a flat out loss. Like maybe the Utah
game. They're not beating Utah.
Yeah. But I mean, they could beat UCLA and Notre Dame. And
I mean, right now, if you took a look at the look ahead lines, I think they'd probably be favored in every one of those games.
Maybe the Utah game. I think they'd be a dog. Yeah.
I mean, they're lucky to miss Oregon, obviously.
Yeah. That's huge for them.
And Washington.
All right, guys, that'll do it for the show. Make sure you have rate and review, and take it to Apple Podcast. Take a screen grab of your review, send it in on the app, SGPN contest. Get that in there for your chance to win free gear every Monday, aka Merch Monday.
Thank you for participating in the Sports Gambling Podcast.
Check out the College Football Experience, all 131 teams previewed with Colby Dant, aka the Dantabase, Patty C, NC Nick, the whole gang. For the Sports Gambling Podcast, I'm Sean, stacking the money green, and he's Ryan.
Sean, Chip Kelly's back in our lives.
Kramer, let it ride.
How are we doing this?